And I won't be here at the closing cocktail reception because
it's going to be long on.
Good afternoon.
Ooh,
I guess we are hot. Well, that goes without saying.
What'd you point down?
Whoa. Okay, so welcome. So if you've been attending panels today, most of them have been about linear distribution. There's been some talk about social media, but we haven't really talked about story worlds or communities or multi-platform storytelling or the technology that enables a really rich audience experience. So that's what we're going to talk about today. I'm Brian Hurst, and I'm the CEO of the Opportunity Management Company, and briefly, Up Management does deals, brokers deals between storytellers and technology companies. These are new business models where content is funded, allowing the storytellers to keep their rights. And we integrate brands, which is why Lori and I are so close, and distribution. And should you have any questions about the company, we'll be happy to answer what kind of content we're looking for. And my lovely partner, Amber J. Lawson, is sitting back there, and she's waving now. And she's a legend in her own mind, so I'm sure you all know her. Okay, so I just would like a show of hands. How many content producers do we have in the audience? And how many people coming from the world of advertising? And how many people coming from the world of technology? Social media? Well, there are a lot of hands that haven't gone up. Hot dog salesman? Okay, so hopefully we will inform you. If you don't know what augmented reality is, raise your hand. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. I'm going to give this to Lori, and then we'll get started. Please define augmented reality, Ms. Schwartz.
Certainly. Augmented reality is when an additional layer or piece of content is added to an experience, usually through your camera, phone, or it could be through a camera in a store environment or even now on your television set. But what happens is when that camera hits an image, an experience, it triggers another layer of digital content, a digital asset. And so you have additional experiences that are happening now through the phone and through other camera devices.
And so the reality you're looking at through your phone
is augmented.
Is augmented. That's very clever. Okay, so we're really lucky today in that we have Brad and Bruno here, and they are the two leading companies early in. Very early, and your company started when?
1999.
That was before reality was really reality. And
2009.
And 2009.
We waited a decade to be by.
So 10 years apart. Well, it's important to learn from their mistakes.
Right.
So Bruno, we're going to actually see augmented reality demos here, and then we're going to discuss how it affects storytelling, how it affects commerce and advertising. That's why Lori's here, and we did have some panel attrition. Robert Rice had a family emergency, so we wish him well, and John Swords disappeared. We have no idea. Into another reality, probably. Bruno, can you tell us a little bit about Total Immersion and show your words?
Sure. So what I'm going to do, I will start immediately with some augmented reality presentation so you can really see what that is and how it works. So I have here an iPad. That's definitely a regular iPad I have. I'm going to start a very simple demo called Magic Mirror, and you're going to see exactly what can be done using augmented reality. So let me find the app. Here it is. So basically what it's going to do here, you're going to see I'm live, okay, and I'm a live mode. I'm just going to record my face. I'm going to slightly recognize my face, and that's what we call augmented reality. It's how we can, emerge in real time 3D animation on top of any live video.
And I have never wanted you more than right now.
So basically here, what you see is like three processes. I'm going to talk just techniques for a few minutes. Three processes in real time. The first one is what we call recognition, so we can recognize anybody's faces. We can recognize, brochure, trading cards. It could be business cards, greeting cards, or any physical object. And then the second one is tracking. I mean, how I can move my head and being able to, superimpose in real-time 3D animation. So that's, and the third one is what we call rendering. Once we know where the face is, we can start to superimpose in real-time 3D animation. So that's the one we did for a movie called Rise of the Apes. And so basically here, that's a project we did for Fox. And you're gonna see that's a way to, same, recognize the face, record it. I'm gonna scan my face, and then suddenly I turned to names.
Cool. And creepy.
Hey. And so that's a funny one. And basically here we have also all social components. We can you know, record video, we can also take photo and share that with our friends on Facebook. And the third demonstration I would like to showcase today is also how we can use, you know, trading cards. So here I have, you know, Ben 10 trading cards, totally regular trading cards. There is no special things, no markers, no barcodes or whatever on the trading cards. For that one, I'm going to use the...
So when you say no special markers on the trading cards, there's nothing on the trading card that cues the program.
Exactly.
The program is able to recognize the trading card.
Exactly. So there is, we just can recognize texture, colors, information. As soon as we have a logo or any colors, we can start, you know, tracking any physical device. So here we have one card. I mean, you can see that I can interact with it. I have another one here that's going to show up shortly. And then when the two cards are facing each other, they start fighting, you know. So that's another one here, you know.
So you have the two cards opposing each other,
yep,
on a flat surface, shooting it through the camera of the iPad.
Exactly. And, you know, superposing a totally new three-dimension story that could be, you know, superimposed on a 2D dimension story, which is business card. So that's the way we define augmented reality, is really how we can, you know, engage, emerge any physical object or any users, and how we can transform, you know, passive guests into a more active performer. So you want to see this yourself into the experience. So I have here a quick video that's going to showcase, you know, some of the experience that we delivered with some clients. So I'm going to start from the beginning. So here we go. So I'm going to comment them, actually. So the first one is during a live event, you know, how you can, here it was pretty much the same configuration, someone on stage, and then we could superimpose on a 3D animation live on stage that you're going to be able to take a look at the video projector. So if you look at me, you don't see any 3D animation, but if you look at the screen, then you're going to start seeing the merge of the real and the virtual. So, you know, that's the first application for AR for live stage exhibition shows where you can, you know, more and more engage the audience into a very interactive show in real time. So same here, it was for oil company. Pretty interactive show that really wow with the audience, and they can see themselves. A lot of interactivity, I mean, how we can track more and more gesture information. So here working with Google, that was for also another big event, you know, where you can have a big screen in front of you and you are kind of interacting with three animations. Here it's Simple Rabbits. Same, but for, you know, street marketing application, how you can dance with a 3D character or fight against a 3D character in real time. Very popular. We are doing more and more of that stuff, actually. Packaging, so that's for DVD, how you can engage, you know, the audience. And when you have the two packs, then the two packs can start interacting together in real time. Pretty much the same that I just did with the trading card a few minutes ago. Some games application here with Yahoo, where you can use your phone, use your brochure as a kind of way to interact with a 3D car in real time. How you want to play a game into your world. I mean, basically here we are, you know, emerging a racetrack in your home. So your home is the way to play to differently to a game. That's an application we released recently. We have now 40,000 downloads. It's a game where you can, you know, interact with your face, called Skin Invaders. Working with, you know, a car manufacturer company for customizing 3D car in real time. Here, that's a project we did with Volkswagen. E-commerce, we're going to talk about it today. It's very important. How you can try product without going to a store. So here we are trying glasses in real time. Could be watch, how you can try your watch in real time. And clothes. I mean, basically the the Graal for augmented reality is how you're going to be able to try closures without going to a fitting room and doing that either in your house or into a different location. So that was a brief video, and I have just few slides to finish to introduce Toro Motion. So basically, Toro Motion, we are an 85 people team. Basically here, I think you get it, is everything is going digital, and we don't want to forget that we are human, and we want to be part of the experience. How we could, you know, converge and get some real objects and virtual objects being able to interact together in real time. You know, a lot of things regarding customer engagement, virtual fitting room, advert gaming, on-stage event, on-street marketing, traffic generation, innovating brand image, you know, all that stuff that are really keen for, important for augmented reality. Different location. What is important is we delivered over the past 2 years more than 1,000 AR applications. So we know what works and we know what is not working. And I'm used to saying to our clients, either advertising or studios, okay, let's work together on bringing creativity to the next step using augmented reality. End users are ready. I mean, you have more and more devices that are ready for augmented reality. You can have AR now on your phone. You can have AR on your tablet. You can have AR on your computer. And shortly, we believe that you're going to have AR directly on your screen with some IPTV application. So that's it. It was a quick intro.
But it was quite diverse. I didn't ask how many people are marketing executives. Okay. Brad.
Mine's a puppet show. No, I'll show here a video in a minute. Augmento was formed 2 years ago. A bunch of video game executives, we came together recognizing the coming Kinect was going to be a very powerful tool to really take gaming to the next level, to really interact in a much deeper level than ever been possible before. We realized the big leap was going to be mobile. That it's one thing to interact with characters and assets inside of your living room. It's another thing to take it to the street. The actual way to describe Augmento is an augmented reality location-based game company. And that second half is extremely important to understand because it makes the first half even more impactful, meaning that we know where you're playing and also what you're seeing. We understand that augmented reality is a very valuable tool to interact with the world around you. The location-based side of that understands where you are when you're interacting with it. So the simple way to describe this is when you look at Foursquare or a scavenger and you're checking into Starbucks near you, you could be 300 yards away and not really know if you're inside Starbucks. And Starbucks really doesn't know if you're inside of its own facility. But with us, we actually know not only where you are in the local vicinity, but it actually can recognize the Starbucks brand. It can recognize what you're doing. So we took that into a gaming side. We thought that bringing the games into the real world was going to be really impactful in a bunch of different ways. We took the Paranormal Activity license about a year ago and brought ghosts in the real world. And the reason why we picked Paranormal Activity is we knew it was an annualized brand, that every year there was a new film coming out that would push the marketing and the awareness level around it. And we bring players and users on into the app and actually have them experience these ghosts. But the ghosts were actually triggered where you were. So if you're near a hospital, missions would pop up that would bring ghost-like elements into the app with you. And you were battling against other players on territory in that actual game. About 30 days ago, we just released our second game, which is NBA King of the Court. So we took the NBA license and applied that same model to real-world gaming. So you're actually shooting on baskets in the real world. So the virtual baskets are placed in strategic locations around you, and you're battling over control over that specific court. If you control that court, you get to scale up to bigger courts. So if you control your town, then you can control your city, your state, country, world. So we actually have players competing against each other over King of the World status that are based in Italy, Australia, and the US. They're all going after each other on a much greater level. But what was very fascinating, at least for the NBA and for us, is you know, we call it our Groupon kind of feel. We can localize these experiences. So we can do things in local markets that doesn't impact the rest of the game. We can have aspects of it that work with somebody like the Knicks in New York City that is a combination with Ray's Pizza and Madison Square Garden that's impacting the game flow just in that area. So we can have our phone and our technology recognize Ray's Pizza, its location, the fact that they're near Madison Square Garden, and give away certain things for them if they're king of that specific court in that specific location. People in Los Angeles that are Lakers fans would have no idea that's actually happening in New York. For the Lakers, for the Knicks, for the Toronto Raptors, whoever else, they like that because as much as they like the NBA as a league, they care most about their own localized teams. And fans are more loyal to a Lakers than they are to NBA. They care more about their own team than they do about the league in general. So for us, it's all about building that whole entire facet out. But you know, to really understand kind of what that means, we can show you a quick video of our next game. It's kind of a teaser we're going to be releasing here shortly. It's a rough video right now, but what it's going to show you is kind of where we're going to take this game so you kind of understand real-world interaction in a mobile kind of basis. I mean, I did it too fast for you. I teed you up too quick.
Roll tape.
There's no tape anymore.
I know.
Slam is a new type of technology that actually understands where it's looking, where it's was looking at, and where it is right in the environment around it. Keep in mind we're a startup, so our video production facilities are not so great, but you'll understand what he's doing here. That's a CG tank that's been placed specifically on a street inside of New York City. What's great about it is it's scaled appropriately to the actual environment around it, so it's not a very small miniature, it's not overdone, it's placed specifically
in that
aspect.
And this is what a person would see looking through their phone.
This is what they see. They'd see that it's protecting that Mexican restaurant. So somebody's placed a tank there, and you can't go after that restaurant without getting past the tank. You can see that it's occluding him, so it actually knows where he is in front and in back of the tank. And it's recognizing, so in the actual sense of what he's doing, he's capturing a virtual flag, and the tank now is on his side. So it would turn to actually capture the user. For brands such as Call of Duty, Halo, Battlefield, you know, you name it, those kind of game companies look at this as a great potential for their brands going into the real world. For us, it's also a great opportunity to launch our own original IP. So you can understand now how it's impacting a real-world component and how players who are now immersed in this kind of world can now get that attachment. But imagine, additionally, that that tank is outside of 7-Eleven, and there's an actual soldier right there. And for me to actually go in and get ammo for my game, I got to somehow get past that soldier. I go in, and now I control that 7-Eleven location. But if I hold up a Mountain Dew inside of that 7-Eleven, I get a multiplier on top of the ammo that I just received from 7-Eleven. So there's a much deeper engagement with players that's never been before really available on the mobile sense.
So, A, thank you, yep. And B, I just want to put a plug in from the storytelling perspective, because yep. Well, we have been talking about brand and marketing, and you know, since the day I met you, I've been pushing from storytellers. So if you look at this from a storyteller point of view, yes, brands are integrated into stories, but I was a principal and a strategist on Conspiracy for Good, and Conspiracy for Good, we actually buried clues. So when you used your phone, if you found
right.
The poster or the block or the QR code or whatever that you were looking for that actually brought the video to life that delivered you clues, it was still gaming, but it was a mission inside of the context of a story, ultimately to save the hero
right.
of the story, who was, in fact, a real person,
right.
Well, fictional, but a real body on the streets. So with Conspiracy for Good, what we did was we took a video story, then moved it into an alternate reality game, then moved it into a locative game
yep.
by placing it on the street and turning, essentially what you're doing
yep.
is you're turning cities into board games.
That's exactly right.
Into playing fields.
Yep. That's right.
However, when we look at the future, so Lori and I get to talk about the future a lot. As a matter of fact, it's usually what we're talking about. And when we talk about, the possibilities, I'm sure you've heard coming out of CES that you will have augmented reality on your windshield, what country am I in, on your windshield, and just from my, you know, baby boomer perspective, it's like just what we need, another distraction, as if texting wasn't bad enough. I just see people punching their windshields while they're driving. But the idea of adding, and all of this, you know, if you were at the keynote this morning, you heard them mention data quite a few times. And data is the new oil, data is where the value is, and none of this could happen without data. And I'm guessing that you all are capturing data and user behavior while this is going on.
Right.
So you're actually going to be capturing, maybe you'll be able to capture sentiment, but you'll certainly be able to capture brand interaction, data that will be valuable to the brands and will allow you to change the game that you're playing.
That's
on
exactly
the fly.
Right. Well, you know, it's really interesting. A few years ago, well, not a few, but like 5 or 6, you know, the beauty of what Microsoft was doing with Halo was they were balancing the game behind the scenes. Bungie had set up an amazing infrastructure to balance it for when you were getting stuck on certain levels. So they saw a certain proportion of players that were stuck on a level that the boss was maybe too hard or a little too soft. They could balance it. They could make that boss level a little bit stronger, a little bit softer, and keep the flow of the game going. And those metrics were constantly being fed to them on a real-time basis. We have that same ability now. So we see that not only a metric when it comes to our game, but also in a real-time basis on where it's actually happening. There may be a lot of people playing in Detroit and nobody's playing in San Diego. We can push the game and really focus on Detroit to continue to make that experience or those players there much more rewarding than the
or you do
people.
A national leaderboard
that's right.
that prompts New York to get in the game.
That's exactly right.
Lori.
Brian.
So as the chief technology catalyst, still hard for me to say, I mean, it basically is your job to keep your eye on stuff like this and help brands. And the word storytelling, I don't know if you've been paying attention, the word storytelling is everywhere. Mm-hmm. Because, and I think it's because, and maybe you can argue this, but I think it's because we're, as an audience now, we have the tools to tell our own story. Mm-hmm. Where we used to just have to consume media, we're now creating our own stories. Brands want to become part of the story. In Conspiracy for Good, Nokia was actually a character, mm-hmm. not an advertiser. It was actually a character in the experience. How are brands, you can see what these guys are doing.
Yep.
How are brands responding to this, and what is the further opportunity for brands in terms of not just getting that data, but selling product, answering objections, providing information, because you're there, you're immersed.
Well, I have to say, I'm pleased to see how far things have come in this space in terms of how much the augmented reality has developed, because when I first met Bruno, it was very gimmicky initially, and you saw a lot of things that were just about like making something fun, like a package of Doritos and just making the Doritos come alive. Like there was no brand-centric story that was being told about the product. The augmented reality thing was a gimmick that they got a press release about. Now what we're seeing, and it's great, is the advancement of it in the sense that now it's being used a lot for consumer attention and consumer management. So you're seeing a lot of, you know, what we call CRM, where it's involving loyalty programs. So recently in the UK, there was a Domino's augmented reality where an application was used to put in front of Domino ads on out-of-home signs. So you're at a bus terminal, you hold up your phone, and it told you the nearest Domino's, so you could, you know, literally go to the nearest Domino's, but it also gave you like that week's deals. And then it also had the ability to email the company and sign up and become a member of the loyalty program. And we're starting to see a lot more of that type of play out, gamification on top of loyalty program in the augmented reality world with brands. So I think that's fabulous because now you can go down the marketing funnel with it. Now it's not just sexy, check this out, press release, but now I'm actually accomplishing
and
a
you
business
could,
goal.
And you could coupon right out of that goal, or you could special offer.
And there's wonderful things like, Bruno and I were talking about it earlier, and we were not sure how well it did, but I'll tell you to look it up online because it's just so interesting. It was called iButterfly, and it was done in Japan where your phone literally caught butterflies that turned into coupons. And you collected all the different butterflies. And it's just this beautiful and very interactive example of how to add a gaming layer on top of a user behavior and then turn it into a retail push to store. So it actually drove people to retail.
So one of the things, non sequitur here going.
Yeah.
So one of the things is that, you know, if you observe what's happening now, the stories you see on TV have game elements in
right.
them.
Mm-hmm.
And the games, like L.A. Noire was the best example, but I happen to think Bioshock is a better example, where you're actually in the story, you're immersed in the story. So this technology, number one, when you look at what's happening with, does anybody play with Xbox Kinect? Okay, if you're in this business, you really
need to.
You really need to.
Yeah.
You really need to, especially because the future of tablets and the Ultrabook next summer will have Windows Kinect for Windows. So all the things that you do with Kinect will be available in a portable environment.
But it's kind of a metaphor also for where user experience in general is going. So the things that you're
gesture
seeing,
based,
right, the things you're seeing on Kinect you're gonna see in everything. So it's great to start to play with Kinect to start to.
So now if we took this interactivity to the next level, which is, I don't know if I'm giving away trade secrets of where your businesses are going, but you know, you talk to someone like Tim Crane, and we talk about, wow, so if I'm using augmented reality and all of a sudden I enter the holodeck or I can have, or I've opened something up where I can actually have an automated scripted experience between me and the character. Right. The best example of this in nascent is a company called Social Samba that actually scripts an automated experience. They had some like incredible number about people spending in-story minutes with the experience. Mm-hmm. So bringing that alive, that kind of experience automated, where all of a sudden you show up on the street corner, and here's a perfect example. So I'm walking along with my phone, I'm in Rome, and I have an interactive guide that pops up on my screen. Right. The screen recreates the Colosseum for me as it was in Rome. I get to watch all the players go into the thing. I get to see the people walk beside me. They're all around me. Yeah. And all of a sudden, Romulus, my guide, says, "You're here at the Colosseum." Right. And all of a sudden, an entire script runs. And I could say, "When was the Colosseum built?" And he'll say, "Whatever the year." Right. And how many people were killed here? And you know, that whole automated experience. So all of a sudden, because of augmented reality, it comes up in front of you.
Right.
How far away is that?
It's right now. I mean, they're doing Disney cruises. So you can go around and they go with the different pictures and paintings are around. The kids hold up tablets and they have a story that takes them on a tour of the boat and also educates them on everything else going around. So it's already here.
And it's about Siri, too. I mean, Siri coupled with an augmented reality.
Right. Oh, sorry.
But Siri, which is an intelligence agent on top of an augmented reality experience, basically means you'll have all that happening now, voice activated too.
So if you're a storyteller and you're going to start to create this in your imagination, where do you go? Who do you go to buy something like this? I'm just saying.
You mean who do you go as a storyteller to?
Yeah, if you're marketing it, if you're a producer, I produce this great property, or you know, Amber, we saw a great property in Vancouver that's all about the history of Vancouver, by the way, that brings Vancouver to life much the same way Rome does. But the stories are really rich and the characters appear and they talk to you and and where do you go with that? Because you didn't hear any, not to slam the other panels, but you don't hear anybody talking. I just want to say the foundation for this is when you deliver content through IP, Internet Protocol, that whole interactive layer that lays on top of that is augmented reality, is interactivity, is what you could do. But you don't, what is standing in the way of this sudden mass explosion? Is it, are we waiting for the ultrabook? Is it processing power? Is that they just don't get it? What is keeping this from going like?
Well, who's going to pay for it is one thing.
Oh, that.
And because I can tell you just from the traditional broadcast experience that just because, even if a brand wants it, the network has to agree to it, then whoever has the digital rights. I mean, it gets very complex.
But why wouldn't you take the same model of product placement that existed in Minority Report and put that into augmented reality?
But you got to have users, though. I mean, you know, you got to have the actual scale of people around you to make it matter for the brands. I mean, some brands are going to have a budget that they can sit there and throw out there, and they get 20 people. That's okay because they got written up in Brand Week.
Right.
But you know, for the rest of them, they actually want to see some traction, some sort of engagement. But and again, that's why strategically for us, it was important to go out there and to get brands that we felt that were, again, annualized, that were well known, that we could build a business around them. And if so be it that other brands came in and wanted to sponsor it, fantastic. But we were making money just on the users.
So would it be somebody like J.J. Abrams or Tim Kring who decides that they're going to bring Star Trek to planet Earth?
That's exactly right.
For the next thing, and suddenly you have millions of fans around the world that, that's a great idea, you know? Save the Earth, save the planet.
I think the OEMs also, the handset manufacturers, the connected TV manufacturers, all of them have to start making deals to include your apps on them at launch so that I don't have to think about it and download something, because I think the lack of ubiquity in the experience is also what's holding people
back. And you don't know it's there, so it would have to be somehow featured.
And one thing important is that definitely hardware is evolving in the way where every consumer can have access to augmented reality. I mean, the first demo I did like 12 years ago, you know, I needed two computers. One for the tracking, one for the rendering. It was a 45-minute installation. Now everything today works on a very simple smartphone or tablets.
Yeah.
And that's a way to have a better connection with every consumers, users, gamers outside. And that's what makes the first big splash of augmented reality is now, you know, everybody can have access to AR. You have enough CPU, GPU, and an iPad 2 to start generating a crazy experience that was not feasible even 2 or 3 years ago. And that's just the beginning. You mentioned about depth camera with the Kinect. This is going to go shortly on iPad, or tablets.
Yeah.
And this is going to change the way people are going to interact with content.
Yeah.
The only thing also I would like to mention is data. We need data also to create
and
augmented reality.
And that will drive my people to be more interested in anything.
But also, I mean, you have, I just saw who's their contractor? Google that sends the truck around, that photographs everything. Now you can have Google Maps indoors.
Oh, okay.
Right.
So the whole thing is that Google Maps is really ripe for layering in data on top, and Google Goggles.
Latitude.
Mm-hmm. And Google Goggles is out there cataloging every building in the city.
Right.
So you literally could, I hate to keep going to the war analogy, you know, but you could literally take out a building or two in augmented reality.
Yes.
What I wanted to ask you is, so you know the physics, which is how games appear more real all the time, and it's due to processing and rendering power. So are the physics in mobile, you know, you have the strong arm processor and you have Intel coming up with a new processor.
Yeah.
Are they strong enough to produce that kind of real experience?
They're definitely strong enough. You mentioned about Ultrabook. I mean, they're going to have like double the power that you can get an iPad 2. So we definitely have enough, CPU, GPU to start getting more and more physics. 3D object tools are more and more real and more interactivity, and also understand better the real world. I mean, don't forget that we need to, you know, all that stuff where you need to have to understand the real world, where you are, or gesture information, or, you know, face detection and so on. This is thanks to CPU, GPU that we can go better and better. So the interaction will be even more powerful, you know, in the next couple of months and years with Ultrabooks and others than it was like a few months ago.
Sounds nice when you say Ultrabook.
I also think that behaviorally we're raising a generation of people that are going to expect additional layers of content. And because they're going to demand it, you will see, at least on the brand advertising side, them supplying it. And it will become normal to plan to have that additional content because the consumer behavior is pulling it.
Still, the ad agencies tend to run behind. And I know that this is your job to keep them up to speed. And like Brad said, you know, they want the numbers.
Yeah.
Well, at this point, they actually led. I mean, that was what's so surprising is the last 3-4 years, the agencies were the ones actually pushing AR forward into the mainstream faster than, you know, connected with
anything
else.
It was still
gimmicky.
Yeah.
But the technology was being seen.
Yeah.
Which was surprising.
I think they love it. A brand loves it if they can deliver relevant contextual information to a user. And so we talk a lot about, for instance, the retail experience, shopper marketing. All of this is huge in shopper marketing, because if I'm in a store and I can deliver one more piece of nutritional information, one more recipe.
Yeah, but do you remember the stats that they presented at CES when you guys did the tour about more clothing being sold at retail with an augmented reality?
I don't remember the exact
It was pretty high, though.
Yeah, yeah.
It was over 30%,
yeah, because right now augmented reality is being looked at as a shopping aid. So if you've ever seen Facecake on Connect, which is a shopping tool, or PrimeSense, which is the technology in Connect, they're all looking at being able to just not have to go into your dressing room. And actually, for men, it's not that big of a deal. But for women, it's a hugely popular idea to be able to just stand in front of a mirror, not literally have to try on anything, and have something tell you how it looks on you, and also show you through heat.
Yeah, it's really interesting.
And brands, they are really on top of it. I mean, you keep saying it's still a very gimmicky application for AR, but it's step by step, it's going forward, and it's true that e-commerce and how you can try a product without getting the product in your hand.
That application, when she talks about the heat mapping of that application, well, I don't know if they call it heat mapping, but what it was is if it was too tight,
it showed you
where it was too tight.
Right, which not that we need to be told things like that, but when you look at it from a demographic perspective and you look at it from utility, if you could provide that to women shopping and they could get more shopping done quicker, and they don't have to go through the uncomfortable nature of trying on things, you're definitely going to see an increase in wallet and spend.
And what I noticed about that application and yours is, you know, when we saw it in the early days, it didn't actually fit. It sort of just laid on top of you. But now
it's mapping.
It's mapping to the vectors
which
of your body.
Which is the technology that you're talking about.
That's exactly right. Well, and I think it's really important, too, when you look at that, again, forever an advertiser, and I think anybody that's been on that side has realized when they try to get into the traditional gaming space, the console space, I want to put my vending machine in the middle of a Halo set. You know, the Bungie Halo guys are going to come back and go, that's not authentic to our brand. We don't want you anywhere near. MLB, Madden, it makes a little more sense, but not into the big brands. You know, I could see Skyrim with some sort of, you know, POP display sitting in the middle of the fantasy world. You could have a little bit more resistance there. So you've got all these issues that are coming in front of you, but if you start to bring those bleeding elements back into the real world, and you think of Warcraft, you think of a dragon sitting in front of the Walmart, and you think of a creature that needs a key in front of a 7-Eleven, you start kind of blending these realities a little more and let it kind of nicely and naturally work into the context of real world marketing, there's a lot more potentials there. But I look at it like a CSI and think that the crime has been committed in my nearby shoe store. Yeah. You know, and I gotta go down there because the CSI TV series has now engaged the sort of, you know, show slash game that really embeds me into that world, much like ARGs did for a number of years. That's kind of that next slip. So you go to
JK. And of course, there's nothing like seeing blood on the sidewalk in front of your favorite shoe store
exactly
to prompt to purchase.
You know?
But I think really, and I'm speaking for my demographic, like working mom demographic, I love that I could get more information out there shopping. Like if something tells me you can do this with this or do this or don't forget to pick up that, it goes with this or whatever it is, and maybe I get points. And yeah, add a game to it because I love checking in and doing all of that. But help me get through my day. You know?
Well, so you're talking about...
But take the show outside and do fashion star with that concept,
yeah,
and I'm now the fashionista of the local
place.
Anything
that delivers relevant information is great.
So is it possible... you shot him, and I want to get to questions, so if you have questions, you can go to the mic. But so is it possible that if I vectored my own warrior costume and I'm walking on the street and someone turns the phone towards me that they will see me in the costume?
Not today, but they will soon, yeah. They'll be able to recognize your face, recognize where you are, and you're already engaged, so you're walking around as like a recognizable avatar.
Oh my God, that is truly frightening.
If you sign up for the game.
I can just see the Homeland Security application of this. The other thing that I wanted to ask is, you know, in Minority Report, when he would walk through, they would address him personally.
Yeah.
They would take the cue.
Yeah.
So is augmented reality, that facial recognition and traction, is that going to lead to that kind
that's
of
here now
customized?
And Bruno's got some of it already.
Well, that's here now, knowing that, I mean, in Minority Report, the beauty of it is that you don't need a screen. You don't need a smartphone or a tablet to see the 3D in front of you.
Right.
So a lot of people start saying, when are we going to have to get some AR lenses or AR goggles? I mean, eyewear.
Well, there are AR goggles now.
Yeah, we start seeing, I mean, it's not yet ready for consumers, for everybody. I mean, there's still a lot
bring
of work.
It to your, Kinect will bring it to your TV without much effort.
And this is why I believe IPTV, I mean, we were talking about it just before, I believe that IPTV is going to be a huge hit for AR. I mean,
We were talking about IPTV and the argument that we were basically having, since you're not standing at the microphone, I can tell you're burning with questions, was that the processing power that's necessary for this kind of experience exists in the PS3, exists in the
that's
Xbox,
right.
But doesn't necessarily exist in a Motorola set-top box, even if they went to put those processors
it's
in.
Close. It's really close.
I know,
very
but the
close.
Replacement cycle on a set-top box.
Yeah, but it's fast. I mean, look at Kinect. It has maybe like 15 million units have been sold.
But that's
different. It's not huge. I release a Motorola phone inside a Sprint store, and I'm going to have 30 million people. Maybe
Right. But we're talking about set-top boxes, not consoles. We're talking about the Motorola set-top box that your cable or satellite provider provides.
See, I care about the mobile, though. So the problem is I care about the mobile side, because to me, there's going to be a higher adoption rate than the set-top box.
Right, and that's what we were saying, that with a mobile or a tablet, why do you need it to be in the set-top box? Bruno was saying it would be in the set-top box, and my argument was that, number one, the truck rolls and the replacement set-top boxes, you get to buy something at retail.
No,
you can buy that at retail.
Knowing that
Europe
it's different between Europe, Asia, and the U.S. I mean,
the,
in Europe,
we
can't
care what happens in Europe. No, I'm kidding.
Europe, they switch out their boxes.
Yeah, every year and a half, you have a new box
boxes.
In Europe.
Yeah.
See, well, then that's handy in Europe.
And then, you know, the next boxes they're already working on, you have CPU, you have GPU, and they start to integrate depth camera on set-top box.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know,
already.
We finally have adopted text messaging here. I don't know if you noticed. It took us 10 years after Europe.
But again, go back to, you know, there's brands in the space. Their problem is, again, what's the install base of that if they're flipping out every year, and what's really going to bring them to a store? That's going to be a limitation there, right?
But I also do think it's a cultural thing. So when we go to buy something at retail, like we'll buy that box, that's the perfect opportunity to demonstrate augmented reality at retail.
Right.
At a Best Buy or any other electronics store. And now I'm starting to notice that, yes, all sorts of content and promotions and stuff around this are getting people, or incentive to try.
And don't forget one thing, if Apple release a new IPTV
box,
this is going to change the entire world.
Well, you're also dealing with millennials now who are getting into their middle to late 30s, and they're driving more of the purse at home, right? So I think you're going to also see a shift in digital behaviors in the home.
But I think that...
And in needs.
But I think, you know, you have this thing, WiDi. And WiDi is from your device to your television, to your connected
TV. Wireless display.
And you're going to have the Ultrabook. My prediction is that the Ultrabook will replace the PC. It's so lightweight. It runs on i5 and i7 processors. It's got all that power. So, I mean, I think that, again, we have a certain battle for the living room. But it's not a battle for the living room anymore. It's a battle for what you carry with you and what integrates with your devices when you end up in the living room.
I still, the only reason I twist that a little bit is you know, the value of a YouTube, the value of a Machinima channel, an Allo Digital channel, all these different digital channels that are there, and how many people are watching this consumable content at such a high rate, you know, the value of Xbox Live, the value of a PSN, you know, and where they're getting their content and they're getting that kind of fed to them. To me, again, going back to where I'm going to be a storyteller, where I'm going to actually reach somebody in a new way, that's the place I'm going to grab them. That's the place I have a higher velocity than getting a million people over here. I have a chance for 100 million people over there, and I want the 100 million.
Well, but the opportunity is, first of all, going back to, you know, what Bruce Gersh said on the earlier panel here, which is you've got to have great content.
Yeah. Right.
And,
no matter what.
And what we've discovered is that, so the latest thing in the study that we did last year was, well, if I'm going to go in the movie and spend 2 hours in that movie, that needs to be more than a two-hour experience. I'm committed to going into that story world.
Right.
So when you have a story world that wants people to become involved, and you're building, I had to use the F word, franchise, when you're building a franchise, people want to become involved.
Right.
If you give them this kind of technology to become involved,
they'll be all over it.
And it's not the gimmick that, no offense to Kinect, everything has an adoption curve and a growth cycle.
Yep.
But now when you look at the opportunity to immerse yourself inside the story world,
right.
And it's different from, came and went. The virtual world.
Could be anything.
Everybody.
Oh, Second Life.
Second Life.
Could be anything.
But it's different because now you are really in there.
Yeah.
And you can have these programmed interactions with the characters of the story. You can interact with Captain Kirk.
Yeah.
And the technology that powers this, I mean, there is this grand convergence happening.
I just think the second device now, there's tons of sessions on that here at NATPE. It was all we talked about at CES was the role of that second device. It's just going to play a whole nother role in the home and everywhere else in terms of delivering that additional information. And then you could see the cloud kind of being there to just pump out streams of content. So I could literally be watching a different experience than my husband on the same screen if we're wearing different glasses and different
And will AR live in the cloud?
But some of our stuff is already doing that right now.
Yeah, it needs to. Yeah. It has to.
Because my feeling is, correct me if I'm wrong, that story worlds will actually live in the cloud and consistent experiences will be delivered across devices.
Yeah.
Instead of having to parse your content out in the quote-unquote transmedia model of it, that you're actually delivering the story world because you have the same processing power across devices.
Well, and again, we haven't really dug into that much, but the customization of the content is so important. You know, again, I turned into Planet of the Apes. I want my buddies to see it. The socialization and customization of this content is so strong now that it has a better engagement. We joke around our office that social gaming, you know, is still at least seen as I'm playing Farmville in LA and you're playing Farmville in Detroit. You know, that's kind of social because we're messaging each other, but it's not truly social. Whereas you go to the mobile side and you start playing Farmville here, and I'm able to plant a tree right here, walk away, and you're able to walk up and water that tree, and I could see it growing. And if all of you wanted the same tree, and collectively we made a big tree, now there's apples that we all get to bear that fruit. That's a more powerful message.
And all those apples are coupons.
Yeah, that's right. And those apples are coupons to local grocery store, Whole Foods, and I can go in and get some apples. I mean, that's where it's really going to go.
When you deliver value in wrapped in a great story, that's huge.
So my last question, and then, are there any questions from the audience? Great. So can you just step up to the microphone? So my last question is, you know, with Conspiracy for Good, the advertisers, were actually in the writer's room with us.
Right.
They were part of the writing staff writing their story into the story. Is that going to happen with augmented reality, you think?
Not as much for us. It will be, absolutely. Not for us, but it will be. We like to story first, and then we integrate when it's appropriate.
Bastard.
Content first. Sorry. Yes, your name and your question.
You don't need my name.
Yes, we need your name.
No, you don't.
Be proud of who you are, because we're going to put an augmented reality mask on you, and no one will know who you are.
Anonymous. But I'm a content creator from New York, specializing in new media platforms. An all-inscripted series. And what we usually do is we usually do our own pilots, our own spec pilots. I have one which all takes place in the outer boroughs, which would be wonderful for this. I'd love to talk to the writer about it and probably show him the tank in front of the restaurant. But the only question is, if I do, I know he's going to seize on this and love it. Can I afford this? How much does it cost? Is it possible?
Well, that's it. You have the two best people to have up here, right? So Bruno has the technology that will give you a lot of that stuff that you're able to do. We don't share ours. It's kind of a nice little advantage we have in the space. So we like to kind of insulate ourselves, and it makes us more valuable. So we don't have that competition. But for Bruno, he's the perfect guy because he has a lot of the software that you can license from him and do that yourself.
Yeah,
it's there you go. I'm your own salesman. I get a commission on that.
You know, it is actually more affordable than it was because of the licensing and because it's easier to do now for him. So, and also he has great experience in working with a variety of different models.
Yeah, the licensing is going down, but it's true that we still need to make the production of the 3D assets and to create all the experience. And whatever we do here, we need engineers and programmers, designers to build this animation, and it's going to cost some money. And depending on the complexity of the story, for sure, it's going to change dramatically.
You can talk to Bruno afterwards and see, and then you can factor it in, and maybe you can get a New York local brand like Subway's all over the five boroughs to become part of what you're doing.
Yeah.
That's what we do with Conspiracy for Good, and we actually integrate Subway into the story, or will integrate, hopefully, integrate these brands into the stories.
And you could already have shot something and add the augmented reality on later. You know, that's part of the charm about it, too.
That's true. Some of the things that have been done, we've said, okay, that stapler on the desk will mean something later. We don't know what, but we just know there's a stapler on the desk, and we'll figure it out later, just finish the shot. Thank you very much, you guys. So I hope you enjoyed this. This was kind of like a glimpse of the future, and I don't think that we're really available in some of the other panels because but you've got to consider the future because, believe it or not, it's happening a lot faster than you can possibly imagine. By the way, there are augmented reality meetups in New York and Los Angeles. So if you want to go to meetup and look up augmented reality, you can join those groups and learn a heck of a lot. So Brad, Lori, Bruno.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. And thank you guys for attending.
Thank you. And that's our time. Please be sure to stop by the Facet Room, sponsored by YouTube, for some slushies.